Hi, this is Bee. Today, we're going to continue with the second part of the Endless Runner. In the previous video, we prepared the basic project, we added the input, the character with some animation, and a level with some static platforms to start playing. Today, in this video, we're going to continue with that, and we're going to spawn different platforms randomly and dynamically. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, and remember, you can get the project files if you support me on Patreon. At the end of the video, you will have a result like this. You can see the character, we can still move the character, we can jump. And as you can see, we have the water moving with the character and the platforms dynamically spawning one after the other. In the last video, we created an actor game controller who will be in charge of spawning the platforms and generate the logic for the whole game. When the game starts, ends, lives for the player, and all of that. For that, I have the Blueprint game controller, and it doesn't have anything at all. The only thing it has for now is this table with the definition of each platform. I have this enum to declare which platform is which blueprint, so we have different platforms. And I have all of them here. I'm gonna use this table to spawn the platforms and to take the blueprint from this from here. We also have visible module number, which is the amount of platforms that we are going to spawn first time we press play. The other element that we need is the platform. And this is another actor blueprint. And I created all of these. So for example, this one. This is just a platform with some mesh, static mesh, and all of the platform extends from the actor module, and they have a root, a scene component root to have everything under this element, and I have a start module point, which is a scene component, and an end module. I'm gonna use these two elements to get the length of the module. This is gonna be useful in the game controller when I'm spawning the each platform. And I use this because it's very comfortable to move this around and adjust this visually instead of using numbers. So I prefer this method, but you can use numbers and just check how is the distance of these elements and use that. Then I added with the add component the static meshes from the picking some of this static mesh. And let me show you, because this is one of them. I have a bridge, which is exactly the same. It has start module, end point. Then we have another one with a hole in the middle. I have some collisions, defense. And lastly, I have these three ones. But in this example, I'm just gonna use the center one. As you can see, there's a bridge in the middle. I'm not gonna use this and this, because if we use this one, this element will be in the left side, and we don't have any kind of logic to spawn this in a logic way, so the player is gonna fall and it's not gonna make any sense. So for now, I'm just gonna use this for. If you don't know how to create a new actor, it's simply new C++ class, we select actor, next, and we need to set a name. In this case, it's gonna be module or platform, however you wanna call it. The last thing, let me show you, we go back to the game controller. In this platform table, we have the type ground for the blueprint ground, which is that one. Then we have bridge, two bridges, So all of them are right here. And I'm gonna use this tab, you will see how. Let's move on to the code for one of the platforms. So for example, let's take this one and open the code. As you can see, I have the sync component for the root, the start module bond and end module bond that I shown you before. And we have these two properties to declare which type module it is, with this enum and just the property for the length of the module. But I'm using these two for that. Then I have some getter and setters, get module length and platform type. Next, this is important. This is our getter and setters to check what is the next platform and what is the previous one. I'm gonna use these two when I spawn each platform to set which is the next platform and the previous one. Instead of using a list or any other kind of method, in this case I'm using pointers to instantiate new platforms and link between each of them. And finally I have this destroy module, which is just simply the dots from the actor, because I'm gonna attach, every time I spawn a new platform, I'm gonna attach it to the game controller, and to set everything to null, and finally to call destroy. On the begin play of this module, I set the length of the module with those end module point and start module point. Let's go now to the game controller actor, which remember is the actor which controls the logic of the game and spawns its platform. So here in this game controller, first thing we have is this EU struct. This EU struct that is the one that you saw on the game controller blueprint. And I have the platform type and the blueprint attached to that platform type. This platform type is declared in this definitions file. I also have a game state enum for each step of the game controller. I'm gonna use that on the game controller. Here we have the platform type, all of those. After the U struct, we go to the game controller actor, and we have first is the floor plane that goes along with the player, that's the ocean. And this is important, this edit instance only means that I can only edit this on the level. I cannot edit that on the blueprint, only on the level. So I need to select this from the level. Let me show you that real quick. So if I go here, then I go to the game controller. I have this game controller settings, and this is attached to the floor. The next EU property that we have is that platform table and the visible number, module number. After that, I have this initialize game. This method will take care of the initial spawning platform, in this case, 7. And I also have the spawn new platform method, which is very similar to the initialize. But I decided to split it in two because it was easy to handle. This spawn new platform is called when the character reaches one of the platforms and instantiate destroy the first one and instantiate the any one. You will see how that goes. We have this game state to control the state of the game. We have the number of platforms in spawned. And we have previous platform, some reference to some platform. Previous platform, for player to check, and the first one. I'm gonna use this to see which is the platform that I need to destroy. And this is handy to spawn a new one and set references. Finally, I'm using this one for the player. When the player reaches this one, I will destroy the first one and create a new one. Let's go now to the actual logic for spawning the platform. On the begin play, the first thing we do is we switch to the game state, in this case to prepared platforms. After that, we just get the reference to the player controller and the player and the runner character, because this is going to be useful later on. Then we call initialize game, which will instantiate 7 platforms, initial platforms. And finally, we change the state of the game when this is ready to the prepared game. Next thing is to have this timer and call on respawn after 3 seconds. This will start the game completely, so the player controller will start moving. Initialize game. So the first time you press play, you have this previous platform as a null reference and no platforms. Next thing we need to do is to get the actor location of this actor, because I'm gonna attach all of the platforms to this actor. And we do a simple loop with the number of platforms that we need to instantiate. For this video, what I'm following is just a simple random. In the next one, we will have some rules to spawn the platforms and any interesting technique that you can apply on games. And it's very, very useful, but that will be in the next video. So we will have more platforms and a better way to instantiate all of this, or spawn all of this. So simply, we have the random index. We select one between those three that I shown you, so the ground one, the bridge one, and the other one. And what I do is just I loop through the table to find this index. As soon as I find it, that's the spawn platform that I'm gonna get. If that's correct, we attach that platform to this actor. And we set the position. Then we just advance its position with the length. And this is the important part. If the previous platform first time is gonna be null, remember that, I set this current platform that I've just spawned. The previous one is going to be that one, and the next one is going to be this one. The next platform for the previous one, which is the previous one, is going to be this one, but the first time this is not going to happen. After that, we take the reference to the previous platform will be this spawn platform, so next time this will happen and we will have the previous and the next platform set. And finally, these two if are the second platform is the platform that we're gonna check for the player. So the player will reach this platform, which is the second one, and will spawn and destroy the first one and the next one. The first time I do this, the second one, I set the location of the player on this platform. And finally, I just take if the number of platforms spawning is 0, we take the first platform. So this one will be the one that we destroy when the player is moving. Let me show you a quick picture to illustrate how all of this works. So first time, this is the situation that we have. We spawn the first one, we don't have any previous platform, and we don't have any next one. We keep spawning new platforms. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. For all of them, we need to set the previous and the next. For now, the previous spawn platform will be the first one. So this new spawn platform, its previous one will be the previous platform. And the next one for this one will be the current one. So that's how we link all of them. Finally, when we have the initial 6 ones, we need to set the location of the player. and the player will start moving, and when the player reaches this point, we will destroy this one and we will attach a new one. When all of this finishes on the begin play, we will wait 3 seconds and call on respawn. We clear the timer and we call this function on respawn, which is nothing more than set the player to current lane, which is the middle one, and set this to false. We command the player to start running, so it will start moving forward, and we will change the game state to this state. After this, we go to the tick. The tick only going to happen if the game state is in the running state. After that, we update the position of the floor or all the ocean with the position of the player, only in the X direction. And finally, we need to check if the player has reached the platform to check. Remember, that's the second platform that we spawn. So as soon as the player reaches this point, the X location, we get the next platform from this one. So that will be the third one, first time this happened. And that means the next platform that the player needs to reach is the third one. Then what we do is we destroy the first platform and we set the new first platform as the next one. So the first time, this will be the first platform that we spawn. And the next one we're gonna destroy after this logic happens is the second one. And finally, we need to spawn a new platform. And this is basically the same as the initialized game. And we do the same. We basically take the location of the previous platform to know where we are going to locate this new platform. We use the random again to just spawn a random one. And finally, we spawn that new platform. We set the previous and the next one. And we continue with the loop. So that's how the logic works. Very simple and very powerful. Let's go to the game and let's play just a bit. 3 seconds, the player starts moving and we see the platforms. New platforms coming. The ones behind the player are being destroyed every time. So every time the player reaches a new one, we'll spawn a new one. We set the next and the previous one. So using pointers, they're a bit scary, but in this case they're very powerful because we don't need to keep track of a list, we don't need to sort a list. The only thing we could improve in this code is to try to reuse the same platforms over and over again. This is a different technique, but we could combine both and we will have a really good performance for this game. That's it for today's video. In the next one, we will continue with the spawning platforms. We will apply some rules so the game will make sense. Thanks for watching and subscribe to my channel. Thanks, bye!